Wow. Okay, guys. So let's say you're a hypothetical CRM company called Base CRM, and your goal for this week is to get 50 new signups for your SaaS application, right? You want to get 50 new signups. So what do you do? Number one, you could like search the web and collect a list of 1,000 salespeople, you know, and cold email all of them. You know, number two, you could partner with MaGIC, and you know they agree to feature your startup in an email to all 50 startups in the accelerator. You could get featured in Tech in Asia under an article called, you know, 5 startups that will help you build your sales process. You know, you could get featured in Tech in Asia in an article called like 5 Malaysian startups with like sexy founders. You could have like a whole bunch of Facebook ad campaigns going on, and at the end of the week, let's say you run all these things and then you get 50 signups, and that's cool, but you know, you don't know, you didn't really learn anything, because all you knew is that you ran a whole bunch of campaigns and something worked, but you don't know what worked. Okay? So the answer that I'm trying to convince you of is that you need to build your URLs. Okay, so just to know how familiar the room is, like who's ever built a URL before? Like who knows? Okay, who's ever put like a URL through a URL builder and it comes out on the other end with like ampersand UTM equals something, 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 content term? Yes, no, anyone? Okay, just a handful of people. So we are gonna go over that. And to help you guys out, I've actually created a worksheet that you can download. It's a Google spreadsheet. If you go to, like I figured the easiest way to do this was to tweet the link. So if you go to my Twitter, which is, this Twitter right here, right? This Twitter right here, if you can go to this one, if you can see it, there's a link to a Google spreadsheet, and you guys should be able to make a copy of that. There are 3 sheets in there, and we will be using all of them today, right? I just wanted to give you guys something to do instead of writing stuff down on paper. Yes? Okay, yeah. No worries. As long as you guys have the URL, does anyone still need the URL? Because if not, I'll just switch back to it. Internet slow, no worries. Oh, someone followed me, thank you. Thank you. Okay, so anyway, I'm just going to jump ahead a little bit. So if you open it up, this is the first thing that you should see. And it says, like, you know, traffic source tracking with UTM links. Okay, and it looks super, it looks really confusing right now. But we're not going to look at this right now. We're going to look back at the presentation and think, where did they come from? Okay, so here are a couple of examples. Let's say you're running a couple campaigns. So what we do at MaGIC, okay? So we have two ads, we have two campaigns here, right? One is the MaGIC Academy Career Fair that's happening on Saturday, and so here's a banner that we created for that, right? So, and down here, we have a course, long-term courses on front-end web development. So these are two different banners that we're sending out there to promote, you know, to promote our events and get people to MaGIC's website. Okay, so, but what we do with these is that we're directing them to different parts of the site, and based on, and we also want to know where they came from, okay? So let's take a look at the first one, and what does that mean? Like, on the side here, you can see.
I'm just going to announce for the Wi-Fi login.
Oh, yeah, sure.
Okay, guys. I'm not sure which login you guys are using, but there's one that connects to the one that says MaGIC Academy instead of MaGIC Guest, and the password is the same, MaGIC Elias Cyber, or Master Internet.
We'll see. Everyone jumps on the network. Okay. Okay. So here we have source Facebook. So what does that mean? It means that the traffic, the source of the traffic is from Facebook. Okay. And it could be Facebook, Facebook.com, m.facebook, whatever. Like you see a lot of that these days. Like you see a lot of different kinds of source. But let's just, for simplicity's sake, we're gonna say source is Facebook. And underneath that it says medium, right? Medium CPM. So what does that mean? That means it's an ad, right? So if you see something that like this, that says, you know, CPC, CPM, OCPM, it just means it's an ad. So here, what this means is that we, MaGIC, have run an ad on Facebook, and you know, it's an ad of type CPM. So if you don't do Facebook ads, don't worry about what that means, okay? Just know that it's an ad. So as opposed to if we posted on Facebook normally and you clicked on the link, like this is an ad that we paid for. So what campaign is it? It's part of the MA2015-Career Fair campaign, okay? And that should kind of distinguish it from regular days, right? Because the career fair is a whole different thing. Like, if you look ahead to the next slide, and these are some other ads that we ran, like you can see here, it says, it's still Facebook, still CPM, but it is MA2015-Regular, right? Because that's just the way that we named it internally. We wanted to differentiate, like, okay, who's clicking on the ads for regular MA, and who's clicking on the ads for career fair, right? Because that shows different intent, right? Like if you had, you know, twice as many people clicking on career fair versus MA regular, then you may conclude that our audience is actually more interested in getting jobs and working for startups than taking these kinds of courses, right? So that's one of the reasons why it's important to tag your campaigns properly. So let's go back here, okay? So up here you have Facebook, CPM, MA2015, Career Fair, and under content it says job applications. So what does that mean? Content just means what's in the ad. What are the people seeing? What are they clicking on? So if you look here, if you look at this graphic, it's actually a graphic of a guy filling out a job application, right? So I'm just going to call it job applications because you may run more than one image, right? You may run multiple ads for the exact same career fair. They may all be on Facebook, they may all be ads, they may all be part of MA2015-Career Fair, but you know, one may show like a smiling person, like shaking someone's hand, getting hired or something like that, and you want to be able to distinguish that from the other kinds of ads. Because let's say if you ran an ad with someone's face, you know, like let's look at this example, okay? So let's say you have Facebook, CPM, MA2015 regular. They're both exactly the same. What's the difference? The only difference is that the content is different. This content says Wai Hong because we have Wai Hong's face here, right? And this content says Araya because we have Araya's face here, right? We have ads like this for almost all the speakers, like including myself. Like you may have seen one of these. But the point of that is to be able to distinguish, right? If you find out that people are really, really clicking more on a certain person's ad, then you may think, okay, this person's really popular with them. Like, why is that? Think about, like, why is that? And you come up with some reason, and you might be like, okay, we want to get more people like this because this is what's driving higher clicks to us. So that's kind of why it's important to separate your content this way. So I haven't shown you how to use it yet. Right now, we're only talking about how to classify it. Right. I'm going to go back one more time. And then you can see down here a different kind of content that's not an ad. Right. So this is source newsletter, medium email. That means it's from our newsletter sign up. And the medium, as opposed to being an ad on Facebook, is an email that we send out. Okay. So this campaign is part of the long-term programs for Academy. And the exact content is front-end web development. So does it kind of make sense the way that we're naming these? Yes, no? Yes, okay, you don't have to say yes if the answer is no. Okay, great. But, so, here are some four examples and they're kind of visual, right? So, what I'd like you to do now is take a look at the spreadsheet, right? So, there are a whole bunch more examples here of ways that you can tag your content. So, we try and do this with all the links that we send out, right? Some of them are ads, right? Like the majority, like all these here, CPM, 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 these are all ads, right? And then you can see on your own time, you can see some notes that I've left on how we think about naming and stuff like that. Like just want to give you guys a look underneath the hood of how we run ads and how we track links here at MaGIC and how you can use some of that like for your own marketing campaigns, okay? So we have up here, all the ads. Down here, we have all the emails. As you can see, they all go to different links. And then if you go to site, to site, to site, you get a really long link here, right? So you may have seen links like these before, right? Sometimes you click on a link and you think it's taking you to a short page, but it actually expands to a really long thing. So why do we do that? So the reason we do that is because it passes information to Google Analytics about where this person came from. So I'm going to give you an example right now. So I'm going to copy this link, and I'm going to visit it in my browser. And in the and while we do that, we're going to go to this is a real time panel for MaGIC's website right now. This is there are 14 people on the site. You know, you can see all this stuff. But what's interesting is that you can see here traffic sources, and at this point in time, they're just direct, organic, referral, not set, Google, whatever. You can see this stuff. It's not, if you can see it, it's not super helpful. Okay. But if I were to enter the link that I just copied, right? It's a long link to a page not found page. Okay, that one's not there anymore. Let's try jobs. Okay, so this takes you to the MaGIC jobs page, and then if you look in traffic sources, you can see on the far right. Like, that's the visitor coming in, that's us, and down here you can see email, newsletter, and if you click on that some more, it just says, where's label? There we go. So it kind of shows you, like, what campaign exactly they clicked on. It says here, 13, campaign 13, Ariel Zuckerberg is coming, 13, text only, Ariel Zuckerberg is coming. What does that mean? That was just the name of the email that we sent out. So if you were on our newsletter mailing list, you may have gotten an email in the past couple of weeks with a subject line, okay, MA2015 is here, Ariel Zuckerberg is coming. So what this means is that it came from that email. So we know that if you did anything on the site, that you came, you know, from this email, that you clicked through from this email. Are there questions right now? How do you create the links? Okay, great. Good question. So if you go back to the spreadsheet, right, it's on the same tab. Okay, so first you would want to think about how you're organizing all the content, all the marketing campaigns that you're going to run. Like, as you can see here, we kind of split it up, right? On the very top, you have if I'm just emailing everyone in my address book versus if I'm getting an article written in Tech in Asia or E27, how you want to do all that. So. Number one, you can see on the top in the top here in the header bar, it says other link builders, and there is both a Facebook link builder and a Google link builder. So if you click on either one of those, it'll take you to a page where you can enter. First off, like they do provide examples, you know, so you can look at that, and so you can look at that and see how other people do it. But also, if you copy this spreadsheet and you use it, like in this column right here. This link is actually, like, it's not a link. This is actually, this is a function, right? Like, this is a function in the spreadsheet that just takes all of these things and puts them together into a link. So if you wanted to create a new link, for example, let's say if I wanted to create something else that went to mymagic.my/jobs, and I'm saying, like, let's say I'm going to send it out in a newsletter, let's say email, but I sent another one, and it was like newsletter number 14, and it was like, hey, we are hiring, right? And then the button they clicked on was an image of the jobs. So if I copy this and pasted it there, like it would generate a different URL, right? If you look on your own like spreadsheet, it's there as well, right? It says we are hiring. It doesn't say number 13. It says number 14. So one way to do it, like you can either do it through another link builder like Google's or Facebook's, or like you can also just use the spreadsheet and it'll generate it for you, okay? Every single page of what? Sorry.
Let's say today I use content to draw a topic.
Yes.
So one day I have 10 articles, maybe A to J.
Yes.
So then in the spreadsheet, you have to have A to J kind of thing.
Yes. Ideally, yes, that's what you would do. Because you would want to know, you know, especially if you're posting them all in the same day, and then you end up with this big lump of traffic that just says Facebook, you don't know which article is driving the most traffic, right? Like you don't know what people are clicking on. So this is a good practice for that, right? The truth is that some of you may be thinking that over time, don't you end up with hundreds of links? And the answer is yes. Over time, you end up with hundreds and hundreds of links. But you know, you can just split them by month or whatever if you feel like, oh, you know, we don't need to track those old links anymore. The other thing that's important is that you always name it in a way that's readable to you and makes sense to you. Because you never know when, you know, an old article that you posted suddenly goes viral like 2 years later and suddenly you see this spike of traffic on your site and you're like, where is this coming from? But if you have the links out there and it's named in such a way that makes logical sense to you, even 2 years down the road, then you'll know, right? Okay. Okay, so a couple other things. One, when you try and track every single link that you ever hand out, right? Try and track every single link that you ever hand out to someone when you say, hey, can you link to my site? Don't just say, can you link to my site? Say, can you link to my site using this special URL, right? And the URL should always contain content or the campaign of like whoever it was that you passed the URL to. Like you want to know, like let's say even if you pass it out to 10 friends, like 10 friends who all have blogs, and you ask them to post it on their blogs, one, you may get you'll get the referral information from their blog, but you may also want more content. Facebook. It's okay. How do you turn it off? No worries. Could be worse. Could have been much worse. So here's the thing. Like when you do pass these out to people and when you do release these URLs into the wild, make sure you try and hide these behind like a button or a link or something, right? Because these long, ugly URLs, they're super sketchy. Like they're kind of sketchy. Like nobody really wants to click on them, right? If you see this, like it doesn't look like, oh, it goes to a website. It looks like spam or something like that. So when you do pass them out, you know, try and put them behind an image, try and put them behind a button, try and hide them behind a link, right? Like that's why we have, you know, that's why we have all these beautiful ads of our mentors' faces, so you don't have to stare at these long, ugly links, and when you click it, it just loads the URL, right? Okay, other stuff that you need to worry about. So, on the plus side, now that you know this, yes?
These links will automatically link back to your
email. Yes, because you see, at the very top here, like if you look at the first column, it says URL. So where do you want it to go? Like in this case, it's just homepage, mymagic.my. mymagic.my/afounderstory. And then, yeah, because if you look at the link itself, it's actually readable. Like it's not just a bunch of gibberish, actually. Like if it says mymagic.my/source/contacts/medium/email/campaign/friends, right? mymagic.my/afounderstory/source/tech-in-Asia/medium/referral/campaign/founderstory, right? So it's always readable, and then like the URL, your browser knows how to go to just the URL in front, right? So, and that's the other thing. Like now that you know that this exists, when you go out into the site, you know, and you're reading a news post somewhere, and you click on the link, and you see a referral, then basically you know what other companies are tracking, right? So that's the other thing to keep in mind, that everyone will be able to see the URL that you build, right? Like, even if you hide it behind a button, even if you hide it, you know, behind an image, when it loads in their browser, everyone will be able to see it. So try not to name your campaigns anything that you wouldn't want your users to know about, right? Because potentially anyone could see this. Yes. So every time a visit comes in, if you go to, so we don't need to go to real time, right? Instead, we can go to acquisition, and if you look under campaigns, all campaigns, like it'll split that stuff up, and then you can see like we have certain names here, like oh, jobs 215, newsletter number 12, MaGIC news newsletter 12. Like our naming convention's a little bit messy, and actually you can see here, this is why it's really important to keep a spreadsheet of all the names that you're giving to your links, because there's newsletter 9 and it has a date behind it. And then this one's newsletter 12. And there's another newsletter 12 over here. And there's a newsletter 10 here that has a different date format, right? And that one just says news 2015. And like looking at these, I'm not exactly sure without looking them up, like what campaign they came from, right? So instead of getting this just mess, like you want to see something instead that looks like that, right? That it just says, okay, here's all the nice content. Oh, you know, someone clicked on Vishen's face. You know, someone clicked on Seth's face. You know, someone clicked on Ariel's face. Someone's clicked on Steph's face, right? That's kind of like what you want to be able to see laid out instead of like a big chunk that just says email, right? Okay, so take a break, like 5-10 minutes or something like that. And during this break, do think about, like, I'm not going to make you, you know, there's no homework or anything in this class, but just think about how you would want to organize your own content, right? And if you want to know some tips about organization, again, here in the header, there's what I think is a really helpful resource that really helped to clean up the way I think about links. It says, mistakes big companies, including Google, make in UTM parameters, and that's a really helpful read. So once again, take some time to take a break if you need to go to the bathroom, get some water. Think about like how you would organize your own campaigns. What medium would you use? What sources would you use? And I will be, you know, right here, so you can ask me questions if you don't know, you know, if you're unsure about something, or like if you don't want to ask your question in front of the whole class, you can just raise your hand. I'll come to you. Cool. 10 minutes. Do you have Google Analytics installed right now?
Yeah.
Okay, so...
This very basic, yeah.
Actually, what you can try this out right now.
Yeah.
So, if you build a link for your site... actually, for all those of you who have Google Analytics right now, this is something you can try, right? So, build a link for your site, for your current site. Go to your Google Analytics real-time. Go to traffic sources. And then when you like go to the page, like you should see it show up, like so, and then you can learn, you can see how for yourself how it automatically gets tracked. Other questions? You guys okay? No. Just any, like any normal link, like,
okay.
Like anywhere. So it's not a special link that goes somewhere. So for example,
just build all that.
Like you can copy it. No, you have to copy. Like you have to just put it wherever.
As long as the first link is correct with the URL.
Yeah. So you see, if I put this here, like it comes out with this long link. But like I can even send it to a friend. Easiest way to test it, to know whether something's working or not, is to go to your real-time. Like, real-time is super handy.
What about Facebook? Let's say you put up one app, and how do
you... It goes from Facebook to your site?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, like, you can also ask, they also do ask you where, yeah, for the link, right? So that's what we do, right? In Facebook, sometimes there are 5 or 6 different, you know, like the Facebook ad in this thing, it has like 5 or 6 different pictures.
So here we show that it's Facebook.
Yes, if you tag it correctly, you say Facebook, something, and then what image they were looking, what image they
instead
clicked
of
on.
Putting the pitch link,
yes.
We put these links.
Yes, it would have to be, I mean, let's say if I wanted to create, let's say all of these Facebook ads are from the same, going to the same ad. Like
because
that.
We have different ad set, right?
Yeah, I mean, but that's still fine, right? Because like, let's say all of these go to academy.mymagic.my, and they all say, came from Facebook, came from an ad, and they came from different campaigns, and see, so it's like same, kind of the same, and then here it's all different, because this is like, what picture are they clicking on? Yeah.
But it wasn't enough.
I don't know how I would illustrate that.
I can always illustrate as long as I have content.
This is very technical, so I can show like case studies, but I wanted to know that I'm not missing key messages from you.
The key message is so far. Let me look at my notes. Key messages so far is that this chart, right? Growth is exponential, but like it should be exponential, but it's not like one. Like the myth is that it's one silver bullet that you do.
But it's like one shot situation.
Yeah, whereas it's really not. It's a whole like a thousand things that you do. The other thing is that I think of growth hacking as the growth part, which is it's kind of like this as the growth part. These are the hacks, and there's kind of a framework that you need to be able to do all that stuff. It may be a little bit easier. I don't know. This is a fairly ask for hands-on workshop, so it's a little bit more technical.
As a hands-on, it's fine. So I just need to isolate. And so for me, I always think you offer to someone who didn't attend a workshop, right? So it's not so much that they will understand exactly how to do it, but they will understand certain heuristics.
Yeah. Track every link. Track every link, and you can do it like all this.
I can do one more question on this topic before I'd like to move on. Are there any other questions? Good questions. Okay, cool. So the next. Okay. So now we've kind of figured out like how people get to your site. So the next step really is for us to figure out what are they actually doing on your website, right? And so we're going to go back to the example of this CRM company that we talked about at the first half. So Base CRM, right? So Base CRM. And so what are the things that Base CRM is doing to build its marketing funnel? So a couple of example efforts would be like having a newsletter sign up on the page, right? And we tell people, hey, this sends out sales tips and interviews with sales thought leaders, right? And if you're a salesperson reading this, you're like, okay, I may want this newsletter, so I'll sign up for it. Okay? We have a 1-hour webinar once a week that teaches lead generation best practices. Okay, like so again, if you're a salesperson, you may think, okay, I do want to get better at lead generation. I'll sign up for this webinar, right? And we'll have like content downloads. Like, okay, here are some PDFs that you can download on our website, like a white paper about the state of sales technology, ebook called Closing Your First 10 Deals, another ebook on how to scale a sales team and stuff like that. And then we have like a pricing page where people can come and look at our pricing, and you have a sign-up form, right? Like it's just like signing up for any business software. There's some stuff on there that's about sales, because it's software for salespeople. We have the newsletter, we have the webinar, we have the content in the form of PDFs. We have a sign-up page, we have a pricing page, okay? So all of these things you can kind of consider to be goals, right? Like, because these are things that we want people to do when they come to the site, right? When we come to the site, like, what do we ultimately want? I think ultimately we want them to sign up for the trial, right? To sign up for a trial of our software, and ultimately we want them to pay us money, okay? But on the way to that, there are a lot of things that people could do that we would consider good signs, Because I could come to the site and I could read all this stuff and I'd be like, okay, this is really impressive, but I'm not ready to buy yet. And then if you only consider a sign up as a goal, you'd be like, okay, well, that was a waste of time, right? But it's not always a waste, because sometimes someone will read, like if I come to your site today, and I read this PDF and I think about like, okay, these guys are really smart, and then maybe in like 40 days or 70 days when I'm ready to buy, I come back, and then that translates into an actual sale, that translates into actual revenue, okay? So how do you set goals for each one of these? So in your analytics panel, like in the admin section, right, in the top right, there's a bar called admin. There's a home reporting, customization, something like that. And then it says admin. And in admin, there's a panel called goals. And in the goals panel, there's something that looks like this. Okay. No worries. So you can set up a goal. And I almost always do, there are a few choices for goal setup, and I almost always do custom goals, right? So, and it'll just ask you for a description, like what name do you want to give your goal, right? And then what type. So there are four types, and we're going to talk about them. So what name, that's fairly straightforward, right? Like what do you want to call it? So for example, if we wanted to create a goal every time someone viewed our pricing page, right? Because we talked about this, right? Like, okay, when someone views the pricing page, it's not as good as a sale, but it means they're interested, right? It's better than them just looking at features and stuff like that, and they're like, I'm not really that interested. Like, when they look at pricing, it's kind of a strong signal. Like, it's a signal of intent that I'm ready to think about, like, how much this is going to cost me. Like, I'm interested in this solution, right? So let's say we want to create a goal for every time someone reaches the pricing page, right? So how do you do that? So first off, you would go to name field and you would say something like viewed pricing page, because you will want to call it exactly what it is, right? You will always want to call things exactly what they are, so there's no confusion among your team, right? If it just said like pricing, well, okay. So what does that mean? Does that mean like, they wrote us an email and asked for the price? Does it mean that they tried to compare our price with someone else's using a compare function? But I think you want to be super straightforward and just say viewed pricing page, okay? So this is an example of that. So if you put in viewed pricing page, and viewing a pricing page is the first type of goal. So the first type of goal is called a destination goal. I don't know if you can see this, but there are four types of goals here, and it's destination, duration, pages and screens per session, and an event. Actually, how about I tweet this deck too? Would that make sense for you guys? Yeah, so you can see it because there's some small stuff on this screen. Okay, give me like 2 minutes. And if you go right there, it should be attached. It should be attached right to the other tweet. Okay. So, what's my Twitter? Yeah, that's the slide deck. So because there are some small details there. Oh yeah, that's the Twitter. If you need it again. Oh, if you only if you want to. Yeah, sure. If you tweet interesting stuff, I'll follow you back. It's attached to the previous tweet. So, yeah, like you can see there's two tweets at the at the top. One says worksheet, and the second one says slide deck. And one has a smiley face, and the other one doesn't. Right? So you want the second one. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, just don't worry about it. We're gonna. Cool. So we're back to this page where it says, "What kind of goal are you gonna create?" And there's four. As we talked about, there's four kinds and. We want to go for a destination goal. Why? Because it makes sense, right? Like we talked about, we want someone to visit our pricing page. That's a destination, right? We want them to arrive at this destination, that's pricing page. Okay, so let's say if the URL of our pricing page was basecrm.com/pricing. Okay, so how would we create this goal? You would just do this by in your destination goal details, it'll just say equals to and you would put /pricing. Okay? Because that's the URL of the page. You don't need the first part, you know, because Google Analytics already knows what your site is. So you don't need to put, if our site was, for example, magic.com/pricing, I wouldn't have to put magic.com/pricing. I would just have to put /pricing because it already knows our site is magic.com. Make sense? Yeah. Okay. Cool. So I'm not going to talk about value and funnel for now. Actually, we're going to talk about funnel in the next slide. But that's kind of how you do a destination goal. It's one of the most straightforward kinds of goals that there are. Basically, if you have a certain page on your site that you want users to visit, you just take the back end of that, like the like the URL, and then you put it as a goal, and then you know every time someone visits that site, it'll trigger a goal. Okay, so we'll see what we can do with that in a bit. Okay, so viewing pricing is good, but what if we want someone to actually sign up, right? So let's pretend that on this imaginary page, that from your homepage, you see a button and it says sign up now, and you click the sign up button, and it'll take you to basecrm.com/signup, right? And then there's a form there for you to fill out, and then when you fill it out, you click submit, and then when it finishes, it'll take you to another page that says basecrm.com/welcome, right? Because now you know you've signed up, you're in the app, and you have this flow from homepage to sign up to welcome, and you want to track that flow, right? So if you want to track signups now, what's one way to do that? So you could set again another destination goal, because we know that the page that we want them to land on is basecrm.com/welcome, right? So we can set that as a goal, but we can also create a funnel, right? Because we know that they're moving through this funnel. If we know that every time for someone to get to the welcome page, they have to go through the sign up page, right? Because it doesn't make sense that you'd get to the welcome page without first signing up, right? Like everybody has to sign up to get to the welcome page. So in this case, you just create a funnel. Funnel's optional. You can just turn it on, and then you can create another step. And in this case, we're going to call it viewed sign up form. And then the screen page is signup.html, and we'll say it's required. And then, so basically, what this will do is this will create a funnel that goes from, you know, sign up page here all the way down to welcome. And then if you do that, you'll be able to see in your reports like how many people landed on sign up page. So for example, if 1,000 people landed on your sign up page, but only 300 of them made it to welcome page, what that means is that you had at least 1,000 people who came to your site, they clicked on the button, like they were interested in seeing more, they got to the sign up page, and then when they saw your sign up form, they're just like, nah, you know, like I'm not interested. So what does that mean, right? It means that like they were really interested, like there was some intention there, right? But there's something wrong with your sign-up form, right? There's something wrong with your sign-up form. It's unappealing to customers, right? Like maybe they look at it, they don't trust it, or it asks for too much information. It looks too complicated. Maybe it asks for their credit card information at a time they're not ready to give their credit card information. You know, there could be all sorts of things. But first, you just have to know that there's a problem, right? So that's why building a funnel is important, right? So the funnel is important, once again, so that you know basically whether your pages are converting well, whether people are getting lost on your pages, whether they're getting frustrated, right? And then one of the ways you do that, like we said, is by creating a goal, okay? So far we've talked about one type of goal, right? It's a destination goal. Like, do they go to this page? Do they go to this page? Do they go to this page? And we can do all of that, and we can chain them, you know, A to B to C, you know, C to B to D to whatever, and those are all pages. But that's only one kind of interaction that someone may have. Okay, so there are two other kinds. If you look at the top, we have duration and we have pages or pages per session or screens per session. Okay, so those are pretty straightforward, right? Duration is like how long does someone spend on your page, right? And pages per session is like how many pages do they visit for every session. Those are really straightforward, and I'm not going to give you examples because they are so simple. Basically, if you click on them, it'll just ask how much time do you want someone to spend on your page before they trigger this goal. You know, and you could set a goal that's like, okay, someone spends 3 minutes looking at this page. I would say, okay, they're pretty engaged, they're reading, and I would say create a goal called spent 3 minutes on page. But I don't think that's super interesting, right? So. The last one, it says an event. For example, and in the example it says played a video. So how do you do that, right? Because when you play a video, like it doesn't exactly take you to another page. So how do you track events? So to do events, you have to include something called an event tracker in your code, okay? And an event tracker looks like this. Cool. All right, made it super big. You can always look up event, like if you've never done this before, you can always look up event tracker and just copy paste it. I'll explain to you what's happening in this code. Okay, so to anyone who's not at all familiar with HTML, this A, it just means a link, right? So this is a link, and this is all stuff that we're not going to talk about for now. Like, this is the tracker, and this is the where the link goes, HTTP dot, let's say this is going to ptx, this ptx event, and then this is the text that the user sees. It says register for the webinar, right? So let's say this is a register for webinar button. It goes to a ptx website, and but we, like, so why do we want to track this? Because we don't own the ptx website, right? So I can't get analytics. If someone leaves my site to go to ptx, I can't get analytics on, like, whether they actually went to ptx or they just, like, closed the window and left the page, right? But we do want to know if they went to ptx or not, because that's part of our goal. Like, that's what we want to achieve with these guys. We want to send them to this page where they're going to register for our webinar. So since we can't put analytics on ptx page, what you can do is create this this event tracker. Okay, and so here's what it says. It says on click, GA, Google Analytics. So on click just means when someone clicks this, do this, right? This is what this thing means. On click means when someone clicks, do this. On click, Google Analytics, send event. So that's static, that doesn't change, right? That part never changes. It always says send and it always says event. And then depending on what it is, button, we know this is a button. It's a click because it happens when someone clicks. And then what's the name of the button? We give it a label, and the label is webinar for lead gen, right? Because we want to know it's a webinar, and we want to know what kind of webinar it was, right? As opposed to just sending a whole bunch of button clicks, and then you know people are clicking buttons on your site, but you don't know which ones, right? So it's really important, once again, to label your events. And if you go to the, where is that? If you go to the spreadsheet, the second page is all about event and goal tracking. You can see, like, this is a really long document that I wrote. Well, not really long. It's a fairly long document that I wrote for you guys. So I think even if you're not super technical, it's laid out. You know, it's colorful, and down here there are examples of event trackers that you can include. So once again, the question may be, like, if I were to write one of these event trackers, like, where would I put it? And so the way you do it, like, there are examples here. Like, this is how you would put it in your code if you're just gonna do it in line. So anywhere you have a link, right? Anywhere, why does this slide keep disappearing? Okay, there we go. So anywhere you have a link like that, you can put in an event tracker on click, and whenever it does something like that, like, you'll see it appear in, once again, your analytics account, right? So I'm going to do a very quick live demonstration of what that looks like on MaGIC, okay? So it's going to be all the same stuff. We have our real time, and you'll notice in real time there's a panel that says events. Okay, so here are all the events. And then, look, people are clicking on the button, but we don't yet know what button they're clicking on, right? Like, that's why I said it's important to add a label. So if you can't see this, I'm going to try and zoom in. And right here, you see it says click events read more. Click news read more. All that means is that someone is on the MaGIC homepage, and they just clicked read more on news, right? And someone else just clicked read more on events, okay? So let me do something that no one else is doing. So let's see, it says click events, click news. So if I were to click on something that's not news or events, for example, if I wanted to view program, and I click that, it takes you to another page, but then you should be able to see soon. Nothing's moving. I want to believe it's an internet issue and I didn't just mess up a live demo. Okay, let's try that again. They click on apply now. And it shows, okay, there we go. There's a button. So you see that? This coming in means that something just happened, right? And for the what exactly just happened, we know it was a click, it's a button, and the label was to the jobs, like jobs button, and someone clicked on apply, okay? So you should try and set this up on your own site for events that are significant to you. And once again, the way to do that is by having this code right here. And you just put it in whatever element that you're trying to track. Okay? So it doesn't have to be a link. Right? The thing about this is that like this event handler, this on-click event handler, it works on any element. Okay, so it could just be a paragraph, it could just be an image. It doesn't have to go anywhere. It doesn't have to be a button, it doesn't have to be a link. It will just track whenever someone clicks on this element, like it'll fire. Make sense? You can test it out the same way. Putting it in the browser head won't work. You have to put it, like, because you see, it's not the destination, right? It's not the destination here. This won't work. What you can do, have you used the element inspector? Okay, never mind. If anyone here has ever used like inspect element in Chrome or whatever tool it is in Firefox, right? Like you can actually inspect element, like you can insert the tracker into your code just to test it, and if you click it on the page, it will fire. Like it will fire, and you will be able to see that. Like if you've never, if you don't know what the element inspector is, then the only way you'll be able to test it is by going to your website, like going into the code and adding this tracker. Right, like naming it the correct things, like naming it whatever element it is, whatever action it is, and the name of the element, and then like try and going to your site and interacting with it. Put it inside of whatever element you're trying to interact with. Right, so I have some more examples basically in your spreadsheet. Right, like all of this, like if you do want to track this kind of, if you are interested in tracking this, like take the time to read through it a little bit. The code is actually very straightforward, I promise you. Like, it's not super hard to do. Okay? Other questions? Okay, so next. Okay, this is just a version of, there are two ways to do it, right? One, you can manually insert the tracker into the element. If you do know how to write like a simple function like this, this is a jQuery function for those of you who do write jQuery. Like this will help you do the same thing for this button. Okay, if you don't understand this, don't worry about it. You can just use the first method. Okay, so far we've talked about goals and we've talked about events, right? So there are these two different types of things, and how lost are we? Are we, okay, if you're lost, like hit your hand on the table once, like I won't look. Are you lost? Really? Okay, cool. I'm very optimistic, but I feel like I shouldn't be this optimistic. Okay, anyway, so just for your reference, so there are two types of things that we've talked about tracking. We've talked about tracking goals, and we've talked about tracking events, right? And so when do you know which to use? Because they kind of seem the same, right? So goal conversions here, as it says up here, it says that they are unique per session. What that means is that they can only happen one time, right? So this is useful when you're talking about like a sign-up flow, right? Someone signing up twice on a visit to your site doesn't really make sense, right? Like in a sign-up flow, if you think that something can only happen once, you can make it a goal. If you think it could happen multiple times, for example, reading the news, clicking to see more on events, like that stuff is an event, right? Because you need it to happen multiple times. Like you want to see how many times it happens a session. Like if someone clicks to read the news on MaGIC's page five times during a session, I don't want it to count as one, because that's what would have happened if I saved it as a goal. Like, instead, I want to make it an event, and I just want to be able to see how many times a session people are clicking to see that thing. Okay? So, on the other hand, events can't be part of funnels, and it can't contribute to page value. Okay, so we haven't talked about page value yet. I'm going to talk about that next. Like, how much is each page worth, like, monetarily? Okay? It can't be part of funnels. That means that this funnel that we created here, it can only have destination. It can only consist of destinations, right? You can't put an event tracker into the middle of a funnel. So those are the things that you will have to consider, right? Like goals, if you need to track something more than one time, don't use a goal. If you need to put something into a funnel or assign it a monetary value, don't use an event. Okay, so there are two ways. If you've ever been inside your analytics account and you looked at certain pages, you may realize, like, on the far right column, there's a column that just says commerce or page value, and it has a, like, the dollar symbol, but unless you've done anything to it, it'll just be 0000 all the way, right? That's because Google Analytics won't track your e-commerce by default, right? And then there are two ways to make it show actual monetary value. And I'm going to touch on them very quickly. Like, one is by connecting your e-commerce, right? And I would love to talk you through how to connect your e-commerce, but, like, every time I've had this session, it's too difficult because there are too many solutions. Like, everyone's using a different payment provider. Everyone's using a different kind of website. So there are three ways, basically, you could connect your e-commerce. One, if you're using a platform like Shopify for your website, Shopify, I think, automatically sends e-commerce data to Google Analytics if it's connected on the, like, in your settings. The second way you can do it, like, is if you were using something like PayPal, you could use a connecting service like Zapier to send e-commerce data from PayPal to Google Analytics. And the third way to do it, like, if you don't really have a service that, like, that does it easily, you basically have to read, you have to just look up your payment provider plus Google Analytics e-commerce and figure out how to do that. And if you are non-technical, then what you can probably do, and I've seen this recommended a few times, is to go to, like, Elance or Odesk and just hire someone for, like, $10 to do it for you. Okay, like, that. If none of this made sense, just go to one of those freelancer websites and hire someone to turn all those things on for you. Okay, so the second way to do it is to manually enter a goal value. So if you go back up a few times and you see here, it does say there's an optional value, right? And then when you turn it on, you can add a value, and you can add any value you want to the goal. It can be zero, it can be $100,000, but it'll only display that amount in your analytics. Like, that, like, it's not actually going to put money in your account, right? So how do you do that? Like, so basically you have to figure out how much each goal is worth to you, right? And sometimes if it's something like they make a purchase, it's pretty straightforward. Like, if the goal is make a purchase and the item has a fixed price, then you just enter the price of the item, right? Like, let's say I sell a product. I only sell one product, and the product is, like, $49, and I set a goal for that product. And every time someone clicks, like, on the every time someone gets to the purchase page, I just add $49 to this page, right? So if I know, like, if I go back all the way, like, we go back all the way up the funnel to when we were talking about, like, link building and link tracking, right, we know, like, the person who bought this item, did they come from Facebook ads? Did they come from the newsletter? You know, did they come from a referral, like Tech in Asia, like E27, or something like that? Okay? So if it's a purchase decision, it's very straightforward. But sometimes it's not, right? We talked about newsletter signups. We talked about ebook downloads. We talked about webinar registrations. So there's no money directly involved in those transactions, right? So how do you figure out what value to assign? So there are a few ways to do this. And like we'll start at the top, right? So let's say monthly sales over a number of customers. Okay, so let's say you have this data and you know that you generated $5,000 in revenue this month. And then you know that $2,000 of that all came from people who signed up for the newsletter on your website, right? So basically what you would do is you would take, if 200 people signed up for the newsletter on your website, basically you would divide that, right? Like $2,000 of revenue generated from 200 newsletter signups. So what does that mean? It means that every single newsletter signup is worth, on average, to you $10, right? It doesn't mean they're all spending $10. It could be two people spending $1,000 each, right? Or it could be any one of those things. But you know, on average, because $2,000 of revenue came from your 200 newsletter signups, that each newsletter signup is worth to you on average $10, and like that's what you would include as a goal. Does that make sense? Yes. Okay. Straightforward. 2,000 divided by 200. Okay. Cool. So if you can do that with lifetime value, right? I know not everyone has their lifetime value figured out. Like if you do know the lifetime value of your customers, and you can do a similar reverse calculation, you can use that as your goal value. So what if you don't know? Like what if you don't know, you know, if you don't have your, if you're just starting today, you don't have your site tagged properly, and you're just like, okay, I have no idea, right? Like how much is a newsletter sign up worth to me? Like I have no idea. Like, I have no idea if it's 10, I have no idea if it's 5, I have no idea if it's like 50 cents, right? Like, so one way to do it is you can use relative values. And what does that mean? That means that for all your goals, you do it like this. So let's say we have webinar registration, right? And then we have newsletter sign up. And then you have the actual purchase, right? So you do it like this. What's the actual purchase worth? Let's say the actual purchase is worth $30, right? It's worth $30. So you have one amount. And then to you, you're like, okay, is a webinar more or less valuable than the purchase decision? Probably less, right? And then just try and guess. Like you don't have to be super exact about it. Like, okay, maybe it's a third as valuable. Okay, then we're just gonna say $10. And then based on what you know, like is newsletter sign up like above or below a webinar, right? And maybe it's above, like slightly above, and you think, okay, we're gonna guess it's like $15. Or you're gonna be like, okay, it's worth less than a webinar sign up because they're less engaged. It's worth like $5, right? So this isn't an exact science, right? If you don't have the data, sometimes you still do need to assign a goal value, right? And as you can see here, ultimate fallback, like if you really, really have no idea, just put $1 for everything, right? Like, and this is not great practice, but the reason why you want to do that is because you do want to track something, right? Like that, you don't want to just rack up zeros all day long in your far right column. Like, so $1 value is better than nothing. And then when you do have a better idea of how much each goal is worth, then you update it, right? But you don't want to see like 0, 0, 0, 0. Like, first off, it doesn't look good and it doesn't tell you anything. Like, you want your goals to be able to add up. So when you filter by campaign, like when we look at all the people who came, who clicked on an MA2015 ad on Facebook, we want to know, like, even if we don't know, like, how much money they spent, like, at least you can see, okay, there's $29 in the far right column. It means, like, 29 goals were achieved, right? So it may not translate to actual monetary value, but at least it will tell you something. Okay. Okay, so, yes? Mm-hmm. Mm. Okay, sorry. Good question. Okay, so is it valuable to potential investors? If they were looking at your accounts, maybe yes. To me, I think it's valuable because it kind of shows what, like, how valuable is each traffic source, right? So we already talked about figuring out where everybody's coming from. So we already know the where are they coming from, but you don't know yet what are they doing or how much are they contributing to your site, right? So even if there were no investors in the picture, like if you plan basically never to raise money, it doesn't matter, like you don't care, and no one's ever going to look at your books except yourself, you would still want to know for yourself. Because this is, think about it, like this becomes really valuable when you talk about like paying for ads. Okay, so let's say if every time like you arrived at a price, Facebook ads, okay, so it would be like $2 every time someone clicked through, you pay Facebook $2 every time someone clicks through to your ad, right? And out of every 10 people, one person signs up for your, one person accomplishes a goal. And let's say the goal isn't even signing up, they don't purchase, right? Like one person signs up for your webinar. Right, like of every 10 people that click on your Facebook ad, one person signs up for your webinar, and you're paying $2 per click. Right, so there's some math there, right? Like every 10 people, you're paying $2, that's $20, and then what's your webinar worth? Your webinar is worth to you, let's say $10. So probably it probably means that you're spending more money, you know, you're spending more money on Facebook ads than you should, right? Does that answer your question? Yeah, thank you. Other questions at this time? Okay. Okay, so we are actually wrapping up with this section. So I'm just going to talk about three things that you should keep in mind when you are doing event and goal tracking. And this is probably more general advice. This is a lot less technical than the rest of the stuff. Okay. So one, how many goals should you track? Right, and my answer is like you probably shouldn't track more than 3 or 4 goals at a time. Like, why is that? Because I think that like people tend to get really carried away with goals. One of the problems that we do face here at MaGIC is that we have so many functions, right? Like, okay, people should sign up for this program, they should sign up for this event. Like, we want them to join our co-working space, join the accelerator, and stuff like that. It becomes like really, really difficult to focus on, and we have a large team, right? Like, if you're a small team, you definitely don't want to have too many goals, right? Like if you have too many goals and you're just like, okay, let's look at our goals for the month, and there's like 10 numbers on the board and some are going up, some are going down, you know, it doesn't really give you a direction. Ideally, you should track everything, but you should optimize for as few things as possible. If you can optimize towards one thing, that's probably the best. I'm not saying only track one thing, but I'm saying you can track a whole bunch of things. But what are you optimizing your whole business towards? Like that should be less, like that should be like as little as possible, right? Because that helps you focus. So for example, if you're in SaaS, which we've been talking about this whole time, your goals may be newsletter sign up, a download of a white paper, a registration for a trial. Like if you're in e-commerce, right? Once again, if you have a newsletter, that would be one of your goals. Add to cart may be a goal. And a complete checkout may be a goal as well, right? Like this is totally up to you, okay? But I would say like when it comes to how many goals you're actually focusing on, like the less the better, then you can actually concentrate on that. So number two, most of you should probably avoid assigning goal values to these metrics. So I know I said that you should assign goal values to every metric that you track, as a goal. So what I'm trying to say here is that most of you should not use these as goals. Visit duration, pages per visit, social media actions, comments, basically any action that doesn't produce a lead or a purchase. Why is that? Because I think that when you're a small company and you're trying to optimize for you're trying to optimize for either one or two things, right? For a small company of this size, you either care about users or you care about revenue. You care about users or you care about revenue. And most of the time, it's active users. Okay? And so you don't want to get into you don't want to fall into the trap of thinking like, yeah, you know, I'll assign like 5 cents for a page visit, and then you know you see the visits start to come in, and then the money goes up in the right column, and you start to feel good about it. But like, it doesn't translate to actual business benefit. So what? 10,000 people viewed your site. Like if nobody bought, right? Nobody gave you their email, nobody did this. It just means like you could run a bunch of spam on other sites. Like you could run a bunch of clickbait, and then like a bunch of people would come to your website, but you'd get no actual business value out of it, right? So it's really important to avoid creating the wrong incentives, like in the majority of situations, right? So here, visit duration, pages per visit, again, social media actions. There are some exceptions. Like if you know what your business is trying to optimize towards and it's one of these, then I would say, then it's okay to do it. But in most cases, it's not. Like I'll give you an example. BuzzFeed in the early days, like their, like what they were trying to optimize for was social shares, right? So up here I say, okay, don't try to assign a value to social media actions. But their whole organization was built around optimizing for social shares, right? So that was the most valuable thing for them. And like that was what they were continuously iterating towards, okay? Finally, okay, most important thing that you can do, which I don't think that here, I don't think that we covered this enough here at MaGIC, is that is how to learn from your experiments, right? Like we, it's very common that we'll tell you, hey, do this, try email marketing, you know, try social media marketing, do PPC, do AdWords, do all this stuff, like lay this foundation, and then we never really try and tell you, how do you learn from your experiments? Like, okay, I did all this stuff, now what? Like, now what? How do I learn from it? Okay. So this could be a whole class by itself, but here's a very simple framework that I like to use, and I think could be helpful to you guys. So number one, like when you are about to do any kind of marketing, like you start with a hypothesis, right? And then it's very important to lay it out exactly in this way. This test will increase X by Y because assumptions, right? And this will really force you to be clear about your thinking. You know, instead of thinking, okay, we're gonna go to this conference and we're gonna have a booth, right? Or you could even do that for the career fair tomorrow, right? Like if you had a startup and you were like, okay, let's go to the career fair, MaGIC career fair, and we're gonna open a booth. And someone would say, okay, why should we do that? And you're like, no, it'll be good for us. Like people will see our bunting, like they'll see our company name, they'll remember it. But I think that it's really important to keep yourself honest about what you're trying to accomplish, right? So for example, you may say that you're going to the career fair, but what you're actually going to try and do is get people to sign up for your app, to download your app. Everybody who comes by your booth, you're going to go up to them and say, hey, have you heard of our app? It's pretty cool. And they're like, oh, yeah, I'll download it later. And you just be like, give me your phone. I'll download it for you right now, right? So this kind of stuff matters because it will decide, like, all your actions. Like, this will dictate your actions. If you just go into it, you're like, yeah, we'll just go out there and we'll see what happens, like you're not gonna get, like you'll never get the impact that you want. So once again, always start with the hypothesis. Like this test will increase X metric by Y, you know, absolute number or percent or whatever, because why? Why do we think it'll do that? Like what assumptions do we have? Like in the case of the career fair, like what are our assumptions? Our assumptions are that the people who come to this career fair, they're people who are really interested in startups, right? They're people that are technologically savvy, so they won't worry about like installing apps on their phone. Like we think we'll get a high rate because it'll be a good atmosphere where people are like relaxed and they don't have their guards up and they won't be like why do you want me to try your app? Like they'll be in that mindset, right? So have these assumptions, like be really honest about like why you think this, okay? Number two, run the test, obviously. Right, we talked about like now, how do you know you're tracking what you're tracking? Comes back down to the foundation and what we've been working on all day today. Right. So maybe you might find that it's too technical for you. I mean, that's fine. Like I would say that it's okay to get someone to help you with the technical bits of the tracking, but it's really important that you understand like why you're doing this. Like because you don't have to be technical at all to get this framework. And like I think that as a founder, like whether you're the marketing person, whether you're a technical person, it's important to at least understand like why your company is doing the things that it does when it comes to marketing. Okay, so after that, you come up with a learning, right? Like when you're done with the test, it's really important, once again, some people, they just run the test and it ends here, right? Like some people, like it just ends right here. 1, 2, and then they're like, okay, we finished the test and we got this many users, but now what? So force yourself to come up with a learning. What did we learn, right? Like, did the test do well? Did it do poorly? If it went well, let's say if we did this career fair thing and it went really well, you may conclude that, okay, it turns out that in-person is a really good way to drive signups of our app. So now what we're gonna do, and that's the next step, come up with actionable items for your next test, is that we're gonna look for more career fairs. We're going to look for more startup conferences. We're going to go to more of these places and try the same thing again because it worked, right? And then, for example, if it doesn't work, then you may think, okay, what are all the reasons why it couldn't work? Like, what did we learn? Like, what did we learn from interacting with these people? That maybe people don't like to be interrupted, like when they're doing something. Maybe they don't want to download an app in the middle of the day. Maybe people prefer to do that stuff when they're at home, right? Maybe people prefer to do that stuff when they're waiting for something. Like, what did you learn? And like, what can you use that information to do, right? Because if the answer is, okay, it turns out that people don't like to download when they're out and about. Like, people only want to try our app when they're sitting at home, safe. Then suddenly, like, that suddenly becomes your next marketing idea. Like, how do we make sure that we only approach them when they're at home? Like, when the timing is best? Like, what do we learn and, like, how do we apply that to a next action, right? And then once again, like, once you're done with this and you come up with your actionable items, you go right back to the top, form a hypothesis, and that circle goes around and around and around. And that should be how you get your hockey stick, right? Like, every single one of these, like, hypothesis, test, learning, actionable item, then next, and next, and next, and next, and next, right? Like, that's how you grow. That's how you grow a company, okay? So that's all I really have for you guys in terms of materials. If you look at your spreadsheet, actually, I have a little experiment learning, call it like a little experiment thing here with like two sample experiments. And like, if you were to copy paste it and use it for your own experiment, like, you'll see here we have experiment, hypothesis, target metric, the forecasted results and the actual results, and what impact it has, right? And then, like, on the side you have learnings and action items, and I didn't write examples for those, but I think that you can probably figure out what they are. So I really encourage you to please be systematic about your marketing. Like, if you take away nothing else from today, that when you go back and you try and grow your companies one day, like, be systematic about it. Like, don't be one of those, you know, don't be one of those people, one of those founders that we see that often comes in and they're like, I tried 20 things, you know, I tried 20 things in the last 6 months. I spent like hundreds of dollars in ads and I didn't get a single conversion, right? I didn't get a single conversion. Like, why is that? And I don't know what to tell you, like, because you weren't systematic about what you were doing. Like, you weren't learning from your mistakes, right? You just keep throwing money at the wall, hoping that something will happen one day, and if nothing ever happens, you're just gonna throw all your money away, right? So, okay, we have 15 minutes left in this room. Like, if you wanna leave, you can leave. If not, like, I'm here, general marketing questions. We can talk about something not technical if you want. If you need technical help, I'll be here for 15 minutes. Okay, thank you very much for coming.